Hallo und herzlich willkommen zur neuesten Folge des Podcasts. Und in dieser Folge habe ich einen Interview-Podcast und zwar mit der absoluten China-Expertin Ashley. Ashley habe ich selbst über LinkedIn kennengelernt. Sie selbst lebt ja in Hongkong und bloggt da eben regelmäßig über spannende Trends aus China. Und tatsächlich haben wir uns dann auch mal in Real Life getroffen, nämlich als sie mal in München unterwegs war. Schon damals haben wir spontan ein cooles Interview aufgezeichnet und letztens haben wir dann über die Zoom-Videokonferenz nochmal ein Interview aufgenommen und da werdet ihr jetzt gleich reinhören. Das Interview war so lang und so spannend, dass wir es eben gesplittet haben in zwei Teile. Im ersten Teil geht es eben primär um das Thema E-Commerce, das bedeutet Social Commerce, aber auch um den Alibaba Singles Day, der mittlerweile schon vorbei ist. Wir haben es eben damals vor dem Singles Day aufgenommen, aber ich glaube trotzdem sehr spannende Insights darüber, wie groß Alibaba eigentlich ist. Und im zweiten Teil geht es eher um die Themen Social Media und auch Online-Gaming und da eben vor allem auch um TikTok und die chinesische Version Douyin und das ganze Thema Livestreaming. Also Ashley hat wirklich extrem viel Ahnung, ist sehr sympathisch und es war ein super Gespräch. Ich hoffe, es gefällt euch.
Welcome to a new episode of the Tulum Podcast. Today I have a very special guest here and it's Ashley, who is a China expert. More about her in a second. But I'm really excited to have her today to give us an update about everything new in China e-commerce and social media. Welcome to the
Phenomenal
podcast,
to
Ashley.
Phenomenal to be here, Tulum.
Great, awesome. So where are you at the moment?
Hong Kong.
Right, you live in Hong Kong, right?
Yes, based in Hong Kong. I've been in mainland China for 5 years, then I relocated to Hong Kong, but my business and professional life are all linked to mainland China and I do go there quite often and my team is mainland Chinese. So essentially, Greater China has been my life for the past 15 years.
Okay, awesome. So maybe as a little bit of a background, so I got to know about Ashley maybe 1 year ago, because we share a common interest in everything that's happening in China. And it was so awesome then that we got to meet each other in Munich when you were there to give a keynote speech, I guess. We even got to create a little video and interview in a Starbucks, I think, which was really, really interesting. And so I thought it would be a great time to catch up with you again. But just as a short introduction from my side, so I think Ashley is really a great person to follow on LinkedIn. She has so much knowledge about e-commerce and social media in China. I think she does so many different things that it's hard to describe what exactly she's doing. But from my point of view, you're like an influencer, you're a book author, you're a speaker, you're an expert. But let the audience know what you're doing.
Well, thank you so much, Tulum. What a wonderful introduction. You are also a great thought leader in our space, all about digital transformation and about China and about, you know, really moving European businesses closer to the future through the prism of Asia, which is gorgeous. In terms of what I'm doing, I came to China when I was 17, and since then I was learning China, I was living in China, I studied business in China with Chinese people, and then China became also the centerpiece of all my professional life. I also own a training company which focuses on teaching in-house marketing teams, teaching top executives to understand China opportunity through trainings. We do a lot of strategy sessions, we do a lot of basically keynotes. That's how we got to know each other in Munich a while back. And as you mentioned, I also do a lot of thought leadership. LinkedIn is one phenomenal platform that I love. I also publish books, I have mini books, I have also another podcast. And all that comes together. We have China Marketing Circle, I've got video courses. So I see my mission to bring what's happening in China and what's happening in the digital space and what's happening in the world of social media really closer to people outside of this market to inspire them, but also to let them know what's up, what the future is going to look like really.
Okay, awesome. So you're never really getting bored, right? So whenever there's something new, you just try it out?
I mean, this is the benefit of living in Asia. Right. Yeah, you have something new and you need to just try it out, test it out and do it. And besides that, I'm blessed with a team of 18 people, professionals and experts that actually give me the insights from all these different areas in China, because China is so big, you cannot stay on top of it just being by yourself. You need somebody to give you the most important things and lay them on your table, and then you can go deeper. So I've got a phenomenal team, I've got phenomenal clients, I've got a phenomenal network that keeps me excited and that keeps challenging me. And through thought leadership, I also feel that pressure that I constantly need to, you know, stay on top to digest and give back to people. So it's very interesting, but definitely never boring.
But I think it's also such an inspiring environment over there in China, because so much stuff happening. So I think it's very easy to keep engaged with everything, because every day there seems to be some new stuff that just makes you think, so how does it work? How is it relevant? And because it's completely different from what's happening in the West, for instance. So I think it also keeps my mind excited as well, because sometimes when you like cover technology trends, sometimes you think like, this is kind of boring or this is kind of old. Like when I look at stuff that's happening in the West, and as soon as I do my research on new China stuff again, like my mind is completely blown again. So, yeah.
And then it also keeps you wondering, is it gonna last? Because yeah. We only have 24 hours a day, right? So you cannot be in every single topic. So that is why after a while, you also get to filter the things that you feel are really important and things that are really going to last and the things that are actionable, right? Yeah. And that is why I think thought leadership is so important. Like people like you and me and other experts that try their best to stay on top of things, digest it and give it back, because there's so much information out there. We can all spend all day reading that stuff and trying to get sense of it. But essentially, we need others to guide us and to select the stuff that is important and to focus on. So that is why learning from Asia and learning selectively is definitely the way to go. We shall all learn from each other.
Yeah, definitely. I think this curation aspect of information is so important, because that's just so much, as you said. And I think being an expert is not necessarily about being super smart. I mean, obviously it helps if you're smart, but I guess it's a lot of the value is just like consuming all this information, digesting it. And sometimes it even takes a year to really understand something. Like, let's say, I mean, we're going to talk about stuff like Douyin or TikTok, but obviously it's been on the radar for a long time, but it takes so much time until you actually understand the nuance and what implications it actually has on existing businesses. So even if I told you about a new trend that is really well researched, maybe you need to hear it over and over again until it finally clicks in your head.
Absolutely. You're totally right. Yeah.
Awesome. So this is actually going to be a two-part podcast, because there's so many different topics to cover. But let's first start off with e-commerce. So I hear that something exciting is coming up in November. Why don't you tell us why November is the e-commerce holiday of China?
Yeah, so 11/11 is just about to come upon us. It is probably the most important shopping day and the most important brand day for everyone who is working in the mainland China market. And right now, 11/11 is moving beyond China borders slowly and gradually. Even companies that are not based in China or selling in China, they also participate in it through cross-border means. So essentially, 11/11 is called the Singles Day. It was established by Alibaba about 10 years ago. It's a huge anniversary for Alibaba as well. It was created to celebrate, to basically be the counterpart of Valentine's Day, because everybody wanted to buy a gift for their loved ones. But for 11/11, you can just spoil yourself, buy something for yourself. And somehow that idea really, really stuck. I'm sure that Alibaba planned for it to be something like Halloween. Halloween is also an artificial holiday that turned into one of the biggest candy shopping festivals around the world, and it is going strong 100 years later. So I'm sure that Alibaba had a hope for it to turn into something like that, but the scale of it and also the fact that right now it has evolved way beyond just Alibaba platforms and Alibaba ecosystem, that right now Jingdong is participating in 11/11, and they do it not in one day, kind of not a one day crazy shopping holiday, but they do it from the 1st of November to 11th of November, 11 days of crazy shopping. And right now a lot of social media platforms are also selling on that day, a lot of offline locations. So everybody who is part of this China ecosystem is just game, because consumers demand, and consumers are literally, people prepare for months. They put together their wish list, right? For instance, in our office, where we've just purchased a camera, and it's a very expensive camera. It's a several thousand US dollars investment. And we were actually seriously considering to hold on before 11/11 or buy it on the day, depending on what kind of discount are we going to get. So people are planning and putting together their wish list for a couple of months and definitely a few weeks. So it has also evolved. It's not just that one 24 hours. There is pre-sale, there's after-sale. The whole month of November is revolving around that beautiful culmination. And of course, Alibaba also takes it outside of just shopping. They make sure that it is an entertainment gala that they run on national television for 4 or sometimes 5 hours. This year, for example, Taylor Swift is going to be singing there. Last year, I think it was Pharrell Williams, and he even, a couple of people, I think it was also Pharrell, who co-authored a song for 11/11. And you see Mariah Carey's and other huge stars that have been part of this gala international stars and of course Chinese stars. And that's very unique. So 11/11, in other words, is the heart of November. It is bigger than Black Friday, Cyber Monday combined and multiplied by two. And you need to know about that day.
I don't have the numbers off the top of my head, but there are always those crazy numbers like that on 11/11, they sell more than the whole e-commerce business of the entire country of Germany or something like that. Or within a couple of minutes, just billions of euros of orders, millions of packages shipped within a couple of days. So it seems really crazy.
Absolutely. And I do encourage you to, guys, all of you watching us, go and check out what are the actual numbers for 2019, 11/11. I predict it's going to be another huge jump because it's been going just up and rising and sometimes rose by like 30%. 25%. So let's see, this is going to be, in my view, another great year. And yeah, the numbers are scary, but essentially it is bigger than any other shopping festival around the world by a factor of many.
I think the interesting thing is that, I mean, obviously China is big, so China will always produce some high numbers, but also the share of e-commerce in China is so much higher than anywhere else in the world. I think I recently read that like already 30% of all retail in China is e-commerce. And I think in the US, it has been around 10% pretty much for the last couple of years. And Chinese people really seem to love their digital buying.
Absolutely.
And e-commerce.
And it is not only digital buying. You need to understand that within that market, it's really the whole system is built on digital. If you can buy online, but for example, the delivery is failing you and you are getting your products 2 weeks later, that doesn't help. If I purchase, I remember last year, a couple of my colleagues purchased GoPro cameras, the latest edition on 11/11. So they purchased as the clock struck 12. So exactly on 11/11 to 12 o'clock at night. And then at 11 o'clock that same day on 11/11, that same day at 11 a.m., we received here in Hong Kong GoPro cameras. Just think about that fulfillment. This is not possible anywhere else. I can order supermarket purchases. They can be at my doorstep in 30 minutes, right? I can be standing there in Shanghai scanning a few QR codes as my train arrives because the doors have products with QR codes. So I can basically complete my shopping list while I'm waiting, while I'm on the train. And when I arrive home, it's already there waiting for me, which is really, really cool. So it is the whole ecosystem. Besides that, there's payments, there's credit systems, there is social media that is linked to it. Nobody is going online to Google or let's say to Baidu to search for products. They search for product recommendations on social media. And there's a lot of social commerce. And there are these very powerful Chinese bloggers that also help sell. So all that, of course, helps. It's not just e-commerce. And in other markets, we don't have that. In about, let's say, 3 to 5 years, we're going to see the proportion of Chinese e-commerce as a part of the whole commerce will definitely rise to 40 to 60%. So think about that. When it is 60% of the whole market, I mean, this is crazy.
It's funny that you were mentioning that people like buy everything on their phone, on the go, while they're like in the train. Because in Germany, you still have, I mean, you have to imagine, there's still a lot of people who will not buy on their phone because they think it's not safe. And so sometimes they will research stuff on their phone, but then they're like, oh, okay, but to do the actual purchase, I have to go to my computer because it's safer. So it's quite funny how different the approaches are.
Yeah, it's a different universe. Essentially, it is a parallel universe because in the West and Europe, in the US, we still have a lot of habits that are difficult to change. China started leapfrogging through processes. They went from cash, not to credit cards, but they went directly to mobile payments. And right now they're using a lot of facial recognition payments, right? And we're still clinging onto credit cards. They went from having to take a bicycle to actually using shared economy and, you know, places like Uber and, you know, Chinese DiDis and all this kind of shared stuff. So they never owned a car. And right now some people own, some people don't. And that is where China is really leapfrogging in technology. They never went to like big supermarkets for a very long time, or department stores are there. But right now there is a lot of fulfillment, a lot of delivery through e-commerce channels.
What I find quite interesting is that, say, in Germany, when there's no technology, the early adopters will only be people who are quite young, who make good money, have good education, or who live in the big cities. Is it the same in China, or is it everywhere? Like no matter the age and no matter whether it's like a tier one or tier two city.
Right. In China, it's across the board. It's absolutely across the board. I always love giving that example. My friend's grandfather is 93 years old. and he is able to go to WeChat, order a Didi cab, pay for his ride, and basically arrive in the restaurant on his own. He's 93 years old. My mom is 66 years old. She can barely, you know, swipe the right way to take my phone when I call her on FaceTime. And this is the difference. And in terms of third tier cities, fourth tier cities, there is a huge economy, digital economy there. First of all, they have less access to department stores and to products offline. So they are forced to order and browse more products online. At the same time, there's a lot of countryside. There's a lot of farmers, for instance, that are using digital technology to live stream their harvesting, etc. And actually, you know, sell through those digital means, not to an intermediary or distributor, but sell directly to people. They sell everything from tea to sometimes live chickens or eggs. Everything can be bought and sold on e-commerce. And of course, third tier cities, fourth tier cities, and lower, they are also very actively participating. In fact, this year in 2019, the sales on 11/11 will be driven by lower tier cities consumption.
That's quite interesting. So why do you think that the technology adoption is so wide in China? So is it that people in general are more curious, or do younger people teach them how to do it? Or is it even the big companies that go out there and educate people on how to, say, use WeChat or mobile payments?
Well, it is everything. It's everything existing in combination, because China in the past 50 years has moved from being an agrarian economy and country to being the world's superpower. Think about that, 50 years. That's less than the lifespan of an average person anywhere in the world. And this speed of change was something that, you know, constantly pushed people to learn more and to act on opportunities. Secondly, Chinese government has been very strong with their vision for China. And if you want to know where mainland China is moving, all you need to do is listen to their five-year remark, because Chinese government issues those five-year plans where they will tell you exactly what is the area they're focusing on. So they used to focus on, for example, entrepreneurship. They used to focus on technology, they used to focus on smart cities, they used to focus on environment, they used to focus on, right now, adoption of AI. They have a vision for what their country is going to be like in, you know, 5 years from now. And every time they announce their vision, every single year for the past 60 years, they executed on it and they actually reached their goal. And very often they surpassed it. So government has been very smart with their messaging. And of course, they are supporting strategic innovation. They are supporting companies that are in those areas. So for example, AI is a big topic right now. So if you're doing any AI implementation in China, you're going to get grants, you're going to get government support, you're going to get money, you're going to get a lot of access to things that are unachievable or unaffordable for other people. And this is the beauty of it. And of course, the people, because they feel that the world is changing so fast from 50 years where they were, not the world was, but where they were 50 years ago and where they are right now, they feel that if I'm not changing, if I'm not growing, then I'm dying. So everybody knows that if something new pops up, I need to at least give it a try. I need to be there. And the whole market is moving fast. The government, the businesses, the technology, and the people. And apart from all that, because people are extremely powerful right now in China, so it's all consumer first. It's not the brand or the company giving them the direction, but the users have the voice. The consumers have the voice. They feel that by adopting it early and having a strong voice, they are also helping to shape this environment. And this is beautiful synergy, I feel.
I mean, it's also, again, like quite a contrast to Western Europe or especially Germany, because unfortunately, we totally seem to lack a vision for the future. So there's no five-year plan. I'm not sure.
And we are afraid of it. We are afraid of it as well, right? So when we start talking about the future, and there needs to be a very healthy dose of skepticism, and there we need to ask all the right questions, just like in the beautiful book by Yuval Harari, 21 Lessons for Questions for the 21st Century. It's beautiful questions that we all need to ask, but our fear cannot prevent us from shaping and actively participating in the future, because it feels that a lot of companies and countries in the West, they're taking backseat or backstep because they are afraid that they cannot see very clearly what the future is going to look like. But if you are taking backseat, if you're not stepping onto that train, you have absolutely no impact on where the train ends up. So that's a little bit where my sentiment is right now with the West-West approaches innovation.
Yeah, so unfortunately, the German government, they don't even seem to have like even a five-week plan for the future. So that's quite bad. And I think it's also interesting that like we always kind of seem to take the glass half empty approach. So whenever there's a new technology like AI, the first question is, oh, how is it going to destroy everything? How is it going to destroy jobs about, say, big data? Okay, but what about privacy? And as you said, I mean, you have to think about some stuff, and maybe in some areas, maybe China is moving at a faster pace that we might be comfortable with, but we have to find a good middle ground. It seems to me that, say, Western societies, they don't know how to deal with everything. And so they just choose to do nothing. And then at some point, they'll just be, say, kind of steamrolled by these new developments. What I would be interested about is also your perspective on Russia. I think you're originally from Russia, or you have a Russian background. And I think just like, say, 20 years ago, Russia would be kind of mentioned in the same breath as China as one of the countries with a lot of potential, say, the BRIC countries, Brazil, Russia, India, and China, and not even getting too much like into, say, politics or stuff like that. But I'm just curious, from your point of view, having experienced the two systems, why is Russia not where China is, even though Russia, say, is closer to the West, also is a huge country, lots of smart people over there. So what do you think are the main differences?
Well, I'm not an expert on Russia, so I cannot speak with the same authority as I do when I talk about China, but my personal understanding of why Russia, as well as India, as well as Brazil, as well as all other countries, have not been able to fulfill its potential as the West saw it. For Russia, the biggest issue is the political system and the way it has been set up, and the corruption and resources exploitation. And it failed to build the consumer sector. It failed to build, you know, capabilities, even agricultural capabilities, only started to sort of come back when the sanctions, the Western sanctions appeared, right? So it was too expensive to import, let's say, beef or import cheese from the West. So they started suddenly building up a lot of factories and manufacturing facilities to actually support that. So Russia is a very peculiar case. And I personally believe that also they failed to see opportunities in entrepreneurship, and there's no companies coming out of Russia, very, very few that have a brand, that have a, you know, that have an appeal, and Russia's country branding, which is generally not a very sexy one, right? So what are the good products from Russia? Maybe vodka, maybe bears and chocolate. So that also doesn't help. And essentially, there needs to be a change in system. There needs to be a change in the vision of the future. There needs to be a change in education, because Soviet education was definitely much stronger to what we have right now in Russia, in order for that country to have a second ring and the second life. And you can also see at the numbers of people that are leaving the country, and you will see that Russia is one of the biggest countries losing their brains, right? Losing educated people. And one of the largest community of expats living globally are Russian speakers, right? It's 30 or 40 million people that are living outside of Russia that were essentially born in that country. In China, yes, there's a lot of people that are also going abroad, but you will see more and more of them going abroad, studying abroad, getting their PhDs, getting their degrees, getting their languages, and then coming back to work, because they know that this is the land of opportunity. And if you want to see the future, you're going to be in China. For many other countries like Russia, you usually go abroad and you are trying to build your future elsewhere. And this also, you know, all this in combination, of course, creates a very different reality. So 20 years down the road, we end up at very different places.
Regarding Chinese people going to the US and then returning to China, I don't know exactly what company it was, but I saw like really cool examples of, say, a Chinese person trying to work in the US and being a quite a low level employee at a regular company, and then coming back to China and then building a billion-dollar company. So quite amazing how much more opportunity there is.
There is a lot more opportunity. And also, you know, the environment, it pushes you. When you are in Asia right now, when you are in China, everybody is hustling. Everybody's family has one or two people that own a factory, even if it's a small, tiny manufacturing facility. Every family has somebody who has a blogger, small blogger, bigger blogger. You know, everybody, even a taxi driver, because my barometer very often are taxi drivers. When I come to Germany, the first thing I do, I speak with taxi drivers. How is life? When I go to China, I do exactly the same thing. And I travel there quite a lot. And they tell me all these stories of their life and how their life improved, and you know where they are, and many of their wives are doing some online shop on Taobao, selling some stuff. It's beautiful. So you will see how diverse and how also advanced, just full of hustle and full of energy that market is.
Really funny, because for me it's the same thing. I love talking to taxi drivers, so I always feel them out about, like, hey, how do you feel about Uber? How is everything going? What kind of technologies are you using? And most of the time I end up giving like free consulting, basically telling them, hey, you know, there's this thing called search engine optimization. try to rank first for Munich plus airport. Or if you have a really cool car, put it on Instagram and stuff like that. So it's always fun to talk to them.
To talk to them, absolutely, yeah.
So let's return back to our e-commerce topic. So listeners to this podcast, they know a little bit about China already. So they know about the basics, say about JD.com, about Taobao, about Tmall. What would you say are some of the newest trends in 2019, either in terms of how these established platforms have changed or in terms of some new up and coming platforms that people might not know about?
I think the most important thing that's happening in 2019 in that space is that we see the merger between e-commerce companies and social media. And at the same time, social media platforms are becoming more and more like e-commerce companies. So essentially, let's look at Taobao, let's look at Tmall, right? Alibaba's biggest platforms. Tmall launched their Tmall Life. So right now you have Taobao Live everywhere. You have Taobao Community. You have Intao promotion where you can launch marketing campaigns that are not just advertising driven when you go onto that website and they show your banner. It's not about that. It's really about the community, about the content, about storytelling. They also have their own bloggers. And right now Alibaba is investing so much money to grow the bloggers specific to their platforms so that they will not go and be on Douyin or be on WeChat. But they will be focused on this specific platform. They are throwing in money, they are throwing in training, and I think their plan is around 100,000 new bloggers within 2 or 3 years. So that's the huge move.
So they want to hire bloggers like in-house or partner with KOLs or other bloggers?
No, they own a platform. So that's the difference between the business models of Alibaba and Jingdong. Alibaba is pretty much a platform, and then it invites sellers and it invites buyers to come. And the same with bloggers. They are the platform and they invite, for example, Tulam, you will be the new blogger. If you're interested in this platform, you come, you create those videos, you create the content. But Alibaba, if they recognize you as one of the up and rising stars, they will back you up with, what do I mean by money? They will give you free traffic. So your videos usually can reach so many people, but they will give you more traffic. So they will grow you as the influencer on their platform so that you can, for example, go and advertise for other brands, or you can create your own brand, and essentially you can benefit by being on, you know, this platform, part of this ecosystem. And because contentization, we call it in China, contentization is a big stream, a big direction for everybody, not only Alibaba, but every e-commerce platform. We see huge changes in the way they run ads, in the way they communicate with brands, and also in the relationship that they start having with their consumers. Right? They want to have much closer relationship. And Jingdong, as I said, is a very different business model because they are not a platform. They are an online retailer. So they purchase merchandise, they store it, they resell it, they deliver it. So they are the world's number one retailer. And that's very often what people confuse about these two companies. They are not directly competing, even if they are, but they don't have the same business models. Alibaba is a platform and JD is essentially an online retailer. So they also go a lot and focus a lot on content, even though it's a bit less than Alibaba. They also focus on service. Jingdong, for instance, opens their luxury bag or luxury merchandise repair shops where you can come with your, let's say, LV bag, and they will authenticate it. They will tell you whether this is a real one or is it a fake one. They will also help you fix it. And if you want, they can even help you resell it, because right now, for example, secondhand sales and secondhand platforms are very big in China. They are on the rise. Vintage, we call it. Right. So very interesting. While social e-commerce is also rising, so essentially there's no pure e-commerce platforms, everybody, whether it's a small app for 14-year-old boys or it is Douyin, everybody is trying to link a very obvious and very easy to access sales function, right? So it's all about monetizing that traffic. I think that's the transition that a lot of Western social media platforms were not able to do. They were not able to monetize it effectively across the board. In China, their strategy for the platform is, okay, great, traffic plus monetization. And monetize it now.
I mean, I'm also like a big believer in this kind of content first strategy. And when I think about myself, I will only buy products from companies that I follow on social media. So there's no way that I'm just going to say, search like for some kind of sneaker. And then I'm like, oh, cool, there's an ad. Now I'm going to buy this sneaker because it
those
looks
days
nice
are
in the
gone.
Picture. Yeah, or because it's like first on Google search or something. By the time I buy something, I've had some kind of relationship with the brand, maybe just by consuming their content on Instagram, on YouTube on a daily basis. And I think it's so funny that I guess 99% of the companies in the West, they don't understand that. They're still asking, hey, what's the ROI of content? I can really measure that. Okay, let's still do TV advertising. Let's still do Google AdWords and stuff like that. They don't believe in content. And so they will never hire anybody as a content creator in-house. And that's really mind-boggling to me because like from their own behavior, they should understand that. I mean, there are also people, they also hate advertising, I think. They also like engaging content. So there's always like this kind of disconnect between what people like prefer in their own personal lives and then what they do for business, even though it should be common sense to kind of adapt the same logic and reasoning.
Absolutely. Now, content is extremely important. And in China, apart from content being the king, there's also context, which is the god. And essentially, it's, you can also have phenomenal content-driven ad, but you need to have that as a core. And most importantly, having the context. What do I mean by context? It means it needs to be relevant in the moment to this particular person that you're targeting, that sees it. And this context comes from the broader kind of spectrum of things. For example, right now it's 11/11. So most of the content that I'm talking about and I'm publishing for my followers that are following China is about the consumers for 11/11. It's about the upcoming 11/11 on JD on Alibaba, or it is about cross-border e-commerce for those people that want but can't participate in 11/11 for whichever reasons. So it needs to be context-driven. And in China, the context is changing so fast and it's very different from what it is in the West. So that is why monitoring hot topics, what we call, right, these themes, monitoring trends, monitoring the consumer sentiment is so crucial. We've seen so many scandals in the past half a year that I'm totally going to write a book about it because I think, you know, one scandal was not enough. One PR disaster was not enough. We need to have many more to actually learn a lesson that China not only works differently, but also you need to constantly monitor the trend, the sentiment, the hot topic in order to not only appeal to your customers, but also avoid PR disasters.
And so in China, it seems like everybody is shopping through those big platforms or through the like super apps. Does it even make sense for a company to come up with their own random brand.cn online store? Does that make sense?
To be honest, if you are doing main e-commerce platforms and if you're doing social commerce, for instance, on WeChat, you have mini programs or you're selling through Red, etc., it doesn't really make sense to have a website. The only reason for you to have a website is, for instance, if you're a really big brand and you want to have a beautiful business card that is, you know, Chinese kind of business cards that's there. So when people buy Douyu or even when they search for you, you know, on some other search engines, Sogou, etc., you pop up and you are there. Most of the search, though, is going to be done through social or through e-commerce platforms directly. So it really depends. You can have it, but it's definitely not as functional. Sometimes hotel groups, they love to have their independent website, but still most of the bookings are done on Muffin War or Ctrip, or they are trying to entice the, you know, people to book directly with a hotel. Okay, don't do it through website. Make sure that people book through, let's say, mini program, right? On one of those e-commerce platforms. So these are all the peculiarities of the market. And I wouldn't say never have your website. There are situations and reasons, but definitely less important than the rest of the world.
Okay. But let's say if there's like, say, a Western company that comes to China with the expectation that you can do it only with your own website and only by running ads without any content, that business is not going to do very well, right?
Yeah, well, I think if you are so arrogant, I think it's 100% fail chance. It's not about your website or about, you know, your ads. It's really about the attitude. If you didn't have the time and the heart and the desire to understand how that market works, and it is world's number one online retail market and, you know, digital consumption market. This is the market that's going to impact the Middle East. It's going to impact Southeast Asia. It's going to impact Africa in the coming 5 years. And essentially this market, the ideas that are now born in this market, they're going to be covering 80% of global population. If you did not take time to understand it and cater to it, then I believe that your failure rate rises significantly to about 90 to 100%.
And maybe finally, as a kind of a last question for this first part of our interview, is about the Chinese consumer. So recently, I was really passionate about talking a lot about Gen Z, how Gen Z is adopting different behaviors around media consumption, about e-commerce behavior, but also how they work in the workforce. And I was just wondering, all this digital behavior that we've been talking about, would you say that in China, it's but it's kind of behaving in this mobile only kind of way. And obviously you will still differ in the kind of content or influences that you're consuming, but then there's not such a big difference between, say, Gen Z, Gen Y and stuff like that. So would you say that this generational thinking is less of a topic in China, or even more, because there's even more nuances to it and there's different Gen Zs even?
Right. I would say, first of all, Chinese consumers are the world's most sophisticated consumers, and they are also the world's most spoiled, and they're also the world's most digitally advanced. And that applies to all, let's say, age groups and consumer groups. So for instance, in China right now, there's a huge consumer group, which are the dama, we call them big mamas. So basically the ladies that recently went on retirement, and they are dancing in the square, they are traveling the world, they are enjoying cooking, they're basically enjoying their life. They are so powerful that they even have their own social media platform just for them, just for those that want to dance every evening at 7 p.m. at the public square, this line dancing. They have their own social media and they can purchase products, for example, like loudspeakers or these beautiful dancing outfits or the fans, because they use the fans for the dance. They can purchase all those products there. They have their own KOLs. They have their own groups on WeChat. They have their own plugins for other commerce platforms. They have their own hashtags. I mean, they have flash mobs. It's crazy. And this is one sub.
How old are they?
They're usually between 55 to about 65, 70 years old.
Well, right. Okay. And they know how to do all of this.
Absolutely. They're going to teach you and me how to do all that within their ecosystem. And on their, you know, on their online platform, they have tutorials, they have games. I mean, it's crazy. Then, of course, there are really young people. And I mean, those that are really into anime, comics and game, we call it ACG, right? So they also have their own platforms. And for instance, one of the platforms, Touch Manga, it's called, you're not allowed to upload pictures there. You can only be represented as an anime character. And that's done because a lot of people on that platform are below legal, let's say, age. They are like 12, 13, 14, 15. So they have their own storytelling that you can create your own comics, not just the picture, but the story about your life. And you can sell, you can monetize that comics. If, for example, you consume my content, you really like my story, you can only read it up until a certain part. And then to continue reading, you need to pay me. So imagine this, you can monetize, you can create content, you can be part of a community, which is very specific to extremely young audience. Of course, there are people by tier cities. There are social media platforms where there's a lot of lower tier content, for example, like raising pigs or raising chicken. There are farmers that are live streaming about their life and they are promoting some very cool products like toothpaste and toothbrushes, very general, but they're making money. They are extremely entertaining, and you know, they are helping people in lower tier cities to also spend time because they don't work as much as first tier cities. They feel lonely and they feel a bit disconnected from this whole global youth community. So they just watch each other's content and participate in that. So everybody across the board is a part of it. Even an investment in China, for instance, you want to invest in stocks. Even a financial decision in China cannot be made without first consulting your online blogger who knows exactly what to buy and where to buy. Think about that. Most of the Germans, and my husband is German, so I'm speaking from experience, before you make a financial decision, you go and consult who? Your banker or an advisor. You don't go online to just consult some random person. Because you think that, oh, you know, they're going to probably sway you into the wrong direction. But in China, they do. And there are investment platforms, there are investment bloggers, there is this investment community. So everybody is participating in the digital economy. Everybody's consuming, everybody's creating, and there are a lot of segments and a lot of consumer groups. So we cannot just define them by their age. China is huge. It's humongous. It's the largest country in the world population-wise. So that is why within each age group, within each location, within each interest groups, there are subgroups. And that's what makes it interesting. That's what makes it complicated. And that's what makes this whole ecosystem alive.
Amazing. Yeah, I also like the thing about, say, the financial blogger, the example that you mentioned, because I try to tell people that nowadays the best experts, they don't work at newspapers anymore. They don't work for magazines, because in the past you thought, okay, if I want to know something about topic XYZ, I'm going to read this very, say, renowned newspaper, because that's where the experts are. And I try to keep telling people, hey, the best experts, they can make a lot more money doing their own thing.
By themselves.
So why would they work as an underpaid journalist at some random magazine? And so now if you want to know, really get good knowledge, you have to find out your own blogger, podcaster, special topic expert, because they are going to be like the world's leading experts in whatever topic, but you won't find them in mainstream media anymore. I think it's just so different.
Unless they're trying to build their global profile for half a year just to put writing for Forbes, you know, and then they're off because, as you said, you only have 24 hours.
Yeah, amazing. Okay. When are we going to see you as a live streamer on some of those commerce platforms? Have you experimented at all selling books on, I don't know, Douyin or the awesome kind of knowledge platform, maybe even?
Absolutely. I mean, I'm already on Teachable in the Western world, and it's not really a live stream, but it is a video courses for selling B2C product. I'm the right kind of target, and I'm not targeting the right people. I do constantly explore functions, but I don't build my profile for China. I think that might change because right now I've got one of the projects that they launched, which is a self-development program for women. And actually I was targeting primarily Western kind of, you know, profile. And it's a 4-week program delivered like online in live messages. And we go through this journey together with homeworks and all. And suddenly I had 30 or 40% of women that subscribed. They were actually from mainland China. So I had to open a WeChat group for that. So it might change. And once I experiment with direct selling through live streams, I will definitely update you and let you know. But so far, Western is the way to go, and watching and using it for the client's purposes is also my way.
Okay, so Ashley, awesome. Thank you very much for this first interview about the Chinese consumer, the upcoming Singles Day event, the biggest e-commerce event maybe in the whole world, and the current e-commerce trends in China. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Tulam.